Hey everyone, this is Jyotika and welcome to your 13th HTML5 tutorial. Today, let's talk about images. Can you imagine a web without images? Images are everywhere. Images can improve the design and the appearance of a web page. To put an image on a web page, we use the IMG element. Images are not technically inserted into a web page. Images are linked to web pages. The IMG tag creates a holding space for the referenced image. It is an empty element and it only contains attributes. It does not have a closing tag. And then there are four attributes we want to include on every image element. The source attribute, shortened to SRC, the alt attribute, and the width and height attributes. Every image should have all four. So let's go ahead and put some images on our web page. I have opened the same animals.html file that we created in our earlier tutorials. This file is also linked to our index.html. But don't worry if you don't have an animals or index file. You can start with a brand new HTML file as well. So first, let's create the IMG element, an empty element as I mentioned earlier. And then let me type the SRC attribute in there followed by equal to sign and quotes. So what is this SRC? The SRC attributes specifies the URL path to the image. It tells the browser which image file to load. So let me paste the URL to our image into the source. This URL happens to be an absolute URL to an image on the web. Whenever you use an absolute URL like this that points to an image on another server, you must make sure to specify the full URL in the SRC attribute. And external images like this might be under copyright. So always make sure that you have the permission to use them. Moreover, you cannot control external images. They can suddenly be removed or changed. When a web page loads, it is the browser at that moment that gets the image from a web server and inserts it into the page. So always keep checking your URLs from time to time. And you can see in the browser, our image has loaded. I know it's too big for our liking right now, and images from the web don't always look the way you expect them to look. But we'll fix that in just a few moments. Now, this was an absolute URL, but the URL here can also be a relative link. Like for example, if I have an image called cat.jpg in a folder called images, at the same level as our this page animals.html, then our relative URL path for the image would look like this, images/cat.jpg. If you would like to know more about creating relative URLs, then do check out the video I put in the info card above and also in the description below. Now, it is very important to include the file extension of your saved image. In this case, it is .jpg. But HTML accepts a wide variety of file formats for images. You can even have animated images like GIFs. You can also have PNG, SVG, bitmap, and many other image formats. The most important thing is that no matter which file type you use, you need to include the different file extensions. That's the .jpg, the .jpeg, the .gif, the .png. And make sure that the image actually stays in the same spot in relation to the web page. Otherwise, your visitors will get a broken link icon like this. Now, it might seem that we are done and that's all we need. We can see the images on our web page. But we are not done yet. We also need an alt attribute. Alt attribute acts as a substitute for the image whenever the image can't be seen. Maybe because of a slow connection or an error in the SRC attribute. Here I've put a wrong URL in the SRC and you can see that we get a broken link icon along with some text instead of the image of the cat. This text is the alt text that I put for this image here. The broken link icon and the text in an alt attribute are shown if the browser cannot find the image. If I remove this alt text, then just the broken link icon is shown on the page, which doesn't really convey anything to the site user. So it is really important to put an alt attribute in your image element. Alt text also provides semantic meaning for search engines like Google. So if you put really good alt text into your page, it's gonna help search engines realize what the content of your page is. Also, people who are visually challenged might use a screen reader that reads the alt text aloud to them, and that is all what they will experience of the image. So let's put some interesting alt text for our images. Black pug looking smug in grey hoodie. Orange cat doing yoga. We don't need to say a photo of a black pug, etc. That's too wordy. It's understood that this is an image or a photo. We don't want to use dozens of words to write everything about these photos. We want to write about what's most important. Why are we putting these images on the site? What matters about them? Our text can even be funny or poetic. It doesn't have to be dry. If there's nothing for people to know about the image, then we can leave the alt text blank. So, if you have images that are just decorative, like background images or logos, then you can go ahead and just put alt equals and then the double quotes. Don't put anything in between the quotes, not even a space. Here's an example of when you might leave the alt text blank. In this header, the name of the company is wrapped in an H1 and the company logo is an image. So let's look at the alt text. Maybe we could say panda. It's a picture of a panda. But the name of the company is Panda Productions. Hearing panda, Panda Productions isn't really a better experience. But we will include the alt attribute. So it's clear that we did think about the alt text. And then we will leave it blank. It will be skipped over by screen readers and nothing will be spoken aloud. But if we completely leave off writing the alt attribute instead, there's a chance that the file name for the image will get read aloud. And people won't know if the alt text is missing because it's non-informative or because you just forgot to put it in. If you want to learn more about creating good alt text, I recommend the W3 Alt Decision Tree site as a resource. This site guides you with simple yes or no questions on how to create your alt text. I've put this link along with a few more resources in the description below. So don't forget to check them out. Now let's talk about image size. One of the things that I've always mentioned in my videos and what everyone talks about is the importance of keeping style and content separate. And I strongly encourage you all to not put any type of style attributes into your HTML code and use CSS for styling instead. However, the image tag tends to be an exception because it must include both a width and a height attribute. Now, those of you who already know HTML since some time and are watching this video just to refresh your knowledge must be like, wait a minute, I've never used width and height attributes for images in my HTML, so what's this? Well, you are absolutely right. Until recently, adding width and height attributes to your image tag actually did not make any difference in a lot of cases. However, adding these attributes have become useful again after some recent changes in the CSS world and the quick adoption of these changes by the most popular web browsers. So what is the purpose behind this? Let's take the example of our cat image here. I've opened it in the preview app which is already present on my Mac. But you can open it in any app like Paint or Photoshop. Or you can also view the image info from the Finder or by right-clicking and getting its info. We just need to know its dimensions. So this image is 450 pixels wide and 675 pixels tall. Let me add that information to the image element within the width and height attributes. And we don't include a unit on these numbers. We just put the numbers. It's understood as pixels. It doesn't matter which comes first, the height or the width. In fact, the order of the attributes in an HTML element never matters. We can put them in whatever order we want. So let us save this and refresh the browser. And you can see our image is already loaded on the page and it looks the same. it doesn't seem like typing the width and height did anything. So why are we doing this? Well, once the file is already loaded and on the page, the width and height attributes don't do anything. The browser figured out how big to display the image by downloading it, looking at the file and its characteristics, and using that to calculate the layout. The problem is that if the browser has to get the size information out of the file, then it can't calculate this part of the layout until after the image has downloaded. Have you ever started reading an article on the web and it keeps jumping around as images load, moving everything as you are trying to read? Well, including the width and height attributes on your images in HTML will fix that. The browser immediately knows how big each image is from our code, and that gives the browser a split second head start in calculating the layout and reserving appropriate space for the image before the image itself has been downloaded. This avoids the layout shift as the image is downloaded. Now let's fix our dog image. I also found out the dimensions of this image from the web, and they are 3024 by 3738. And that's quite big. So let us reduce the size proportionally and make it to 650 by 804. Don't stress out much on how to get these new dimensions. There are many online calculators available that can easily calculate the proportional sizes for you. I've put the link of one such calculator in the description below. So you can see now the image is at a much better size than before. But now, by mentioning the width and height attributes, I've hard-coded the size of the image. That's what you call it when you give it a size that you want it to always be. So these images will always be of 450 by 675 and 650 by 804 pixels, no matter the size of your browser window. Now the problem with hard coding the sizes is that if you look at this web page on a mobile or any device that has a smaller viewport size than the image size, then some part of the image might get cut. So to solve that problem, this code is also usually supplemented by CSS like this, where we set the max width to 100 and height to auto. So you can now see when we resize the window, the images also shrink and expand accordingly. We are going to learn all this in detail when we do CSS, but right now I just want you to know that there are solutions in CSS for making the images responsive to different viewport sizes. But there are also some options to make images responsive in HTML, and we are going to learn about them in future tutorials. But for today, I just want you to know that the image tag must contain the width and height attributes every time. The additional thing to understand is that when somebody looks at your page, every single image that you have on your page must be downloaded. So size can really be a factor. When we think about image sizes, most people think of just the visual, how big it is on the screen. They think about just the dimensions of the image. But the resolution of the image is what makes up the actual size of the image. It is the number of pixels per inch in the image. This ultimately affects the number in KB or MB that you can see here in the image info. The higher the number, the bigger the image size. So, when you put an image on the web, you want to make sure that either a human or a robot resizes the image to an appropriate size and compresses it for the web. Don't just stick a 3000 pixel wide half compressed JPG on your website. They are far too big for users to download and will make your site too slow. Downsizing such a large image with the height and width attributes still forces a user to download the original large image, even if it looks small on the page. So always compress the images to smaller sizes. You can pick a balance between the quality and the file size, and you can do that manually or rely on software to handle the task. Try out several options and see which results in a smaller file. Aim to make them download as fast as possible. And that's images for you. Now let's go ahead and review. Firstly, file extensions are incredibly important. you need to make sure they match the file format. The file name of your image is something that you want to keep very short and descriptive so you can avoid using typos. And then the file paths, or that whole long thing that you put in the source attribute where you have images slash pictures slash file name or the absolute URLs. You want to make sure that you are spelling those correctly as well. You also want to make sure that the image is at the exact same spot that you mentioned in the URL. Then you must always specify an alternate text for the image as a substitute for if the image for some reason cannot be displayed. Next, always include the width and height of an image. If the width and height are not specified, the page might flicker while the image loads. Finally, you must consider compressing the images on your webpage to the smallest size possible for faster download speed and improved performance. If you can do these things, it will make it easier for you to successfully use images. And that's it for today. If you would like to have the code for this entire webpage, then I've put some links in the description below. So don't forget to check them out. Also, let me know in the comments if you have any questions. This is Jyotika signing off. Until next time, keep learning and keep coding.